Hello, everyone. I'm pro saxophonist Jamie Anderson, and you're watching Get Your Sax Together. This month, we're going to be looking at So What by Miles Davis. I'm going to teach you how to play the tune and, more importantly, how to improvise on the chords. And even if you're a complete beginner on sax, you're going to learn how to take a great jazz solo in this free online saxophone lesson. As usual, there could be the usual tech fumbles and all sorts of shenanigans going on. I've reconfigured my audio system because I kept forgetting to turn the mic off. So I've got headphones. So if I can't hear myself, probably you can't hear me either. So hopefully that's going to help. There is a free PDF and MP3 for this lesson. Got your bonus MP3 backing track for So What, which is pretty cool. You can get that on the link right down there, which is www.getyoursaxtogether.com/so-what. Oh, there should be no gap in that URL, actually. That's a little bit of a technical error there. Let me just quickly correct that. Right, www.getyoursaxtogether.com/so-what. Now, there's two MP3s on there. One is a backing track for So What, and the other is going to be a mystery, which I'm going to explain to you later. So go and get your PDF. You're going to love that. As usual, please do check out my free 1 hour saxophone success masterclass, which is a bunch of stuff which I know about saxophone, which you can get for free. And it's me telling you how to do it all. There's all sorts of different things in there. I can't remember what I did now. I did it a while ago, but you know, tone, improvising, how to practice effectively, how to practice less and improve faster, more important than anything else. I can see we've got a few people coming through on the chat now. So hi to Naylin, hi Bill, hi Brandy, hi Julie. Hi, Gang of Green Horns. Hi, JazzGuy1304. And David, thanks very much for all you guys joining me. There will be a Q&A later in the session once we've learned how to play So What. Now, we looked into Super Chat and all that stuff. However, it seemed to be not the greatest fit for us right now. So if you do want to contribute something, you can go to this link here, which is buy me a coffee. You get me a little coffee. But of course, everything is free as usual. I'm more than happy to do it all for free. Now, I'm getting more and more emails and comments on YouTube, so you might get a reply from my glamorous... Let's just move this and make sure I don't trip up. You might get a reply from my glamorous assistant. And my glamorous assistant is my wife, Mel. Come say hello, love.
Hello.
Welcome to your Get Your Sax Together debut.
Hi. Hello.
So if you get an email from Mel or if she replies to your YouTube comments, now you know who it is.
Yay. I'm just going to say as well, you forgot, you missed Bill. Hello, Bill.
Did I miss Bill? Hi, Bill.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of people since then, but you went from Jazzy Guy to David. So, hello, Bill.
I think I said Bill at the top, though. Anyway.
Sorry.
Double Bill. Anyway, hi to Bob Sykes. Hi to Florentino, Alan, Ellis, Phil. Thanks all for joining me. So, yeah, this is who you might speak to. But, of course, I'll be answering a load of stuff still.
I'm off. See you later.
See you later. Have fun. Right, on with the main business of the day. The main business of the day is learning how to play So What by Miles Davis. We're going to learn the head, we're going to learn the structure, and we're going to learn how to solo on it. So, what is So What anyway? In case you didn't know, So What is on the best-selling jazz album of all time, which is Kind of Blue by Miles Davis, featuring the horns of Miles Davis, excuse me, John Coltrane, and Cannibal Adderley on sax. There's a whole book just about the making of this album. It's by Ashley Kahn, so you can go and check out that whole book, which tells you everything about it. It's probably one of the most famous jazz recordings of all time, if not one of the most famous recordings of all time. Hi to everybody who's saying hello. Jeff from Dayton, Ohio. Mohammed, Brian from Florida. Thanks for joining me, you guys. Peter from London. I hope you're going to learn something really valuable today. Now, there's so much I could say about the album Kind of Blue and the tune So What in particular, but this marked a special moment in jazz where Miles Davis moved from lots of chord changes and playing lots of up and down arpeggios to playing just two chords in the whole song. That's right, you can play and improvise on So What with only two scales, which is fantastic for beginners. Now, there's lots of quirky things that I noticed about So What, which I've never really noticed before. or some of them I've never noticed before, I've got a little list of interesting factoids you might not know about the original recording of So What. So, number one, the melody starts the bar before the actual tune starts and is played on the bass. Now, there's hardly any tunes in jazz which are played with the bass keeping the melody, and the bass plays the melody for the whole head section. That makes it very unusual. There's an absolutely incredible introduction that everybody forgets about before we even get the famous bass riff, which starts it off. Beautiful Bill Evans piano introduction with the bass as well. Now, for the first time only, after Paul Chambers has played ba-doo, 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 and do it, he goes boo-doo on the bass. He plays a concert E to a concert D, but only on the first time. The rest of the time, he doesn't play it, and it's just the piano and the horns that play it. What's the next interesting fun factoid? There's no horns on the first A section of the head. Now, people kind of forget that. It's just piano, and then the horns come in the second time. What else we got here? There's no horns on the final cadence of each eight bars. There's no horns in the whole first eight, and then for the rest of the three other eight bar sections, the horns do not play the last cadence. It's only the piano. The next interesting factoid is that there's no head on the first A of the tune at the end. They just kind of keep grooving and swinging, and then Paul Chambers comes back in, ba-doo, 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 and do it on the second A. That's something I never really realized. Now, here's another interesting little fact. Due to a fault with the tape recorder on the first session of the Kind of Blue sessions, this track and two other tracks played too sharp. In fact, they played too sharp by, I can't remember how much it was, maybe 20 cents, maybe not that much, but the tape machine was broken, and every master up until 1992 is too sharp. Now, if you've ever tried to transcribe Kind of Blue, you would have figured that out for yourself, like I did. One of the first solos I ever tried to transcribe was Miles Davis's solo on So What. And I learned two things. Quickly, I learned that it wasn't in tune with the piano, which was quite triggering. And then the second thing I learned is that he plays all his quavers straight instead of swung. So there's another interesting fact. But then from 1992, they corrected the pitch and it's all in perfect A equals 440. Last interesting factoid about So What is that it fades out, which is quite unusual for jazz records. Very common for pop records, but a bit more unusual for jazz records. So, that said, let's learn the head. Now, the head couldn't be easier. It's probably one of the simplest tunes you ever play in your entire life because it's just a simple concert G triad to a concert F triad that the horns play. Now, if you want to play the melody part, you would have to play... let's have a little think. Let's try and put it in E flat pitch and we'll put it in. So the top note in concert pitch would be A to G. So for tenor, that would be B to A. I'm just checking I've got my facts right here. I'm just trying to, in concert pitch, it would be a concert B to a concert A. So in tenor pitch, the top melody line would be your C sharp to your B, your C sharp to your B, da, da, which would be these two notes. Now, when you go to the bridge, it's quite simple. You just do it up a semitone, which is D to C. And then for the final eight, you go back to C sharp and B. Now, if you play alto, your melody part will be G sharp to F sharp. And then when you get to the bridge, you take it up a semitone and it would be A to G and then back to G sharp and F sharp. So the tune itself is dead simple. You only got four notes to learn. Two notes and then it goes up a semitone and then back down. We're going to talk about the structure just shortly. So that is how you play the melody. So I've done this little backing track. Let's have a little look at the head section. Bearing in mind those notes I've just taught you. Hopefully this will come out okay. What I need to do now is turn that to there. That's my new little audio setup. Fingers crossed, everyone. Do not adjust your sets. That wasn't quite right. So let's do it like this. Okay, here we go. Let's try again. Yay. Now remember, no horns on the first eight. So that's a C sharp to B for tenor, or a G sharp to F sharp for alto. And then we go to a D to a C for tenor, and an A to a G for alto. And remember, horns don't play the last one each time. Remember, don't play the last one. Okay, then we're into the solos. So that is the head. Now, you can get your free MP3 of this exact backing track, which I've made, by just clicking on the link down there, getyoursaxtogether.com/so what. So the head, dead easy, done and dusted. Right, next, let's talk about the structure. Oops. Okay, great. Let's talk about the structure of So What. It's a standard Tin Pan Alley song form, which is A, A, B, A. Now, that's quite simple. Each section is 8 bars long. I'm just going to get the music up now on screen. So, here we go. On this side, you can see, where's my, on this side is the alto pitch, and on this side is the tenor pitch. So, it's 8 bars for each section, and you do A, A, B, A. So you play A section, you repeat it. Then you have a B section, which goes up a semitone, and then you have another A section to finish. Now, the take-home point here, and the bit that everybody struggles with, is that because you've got 2 A sections at the start and 1 A section at the end, you end up playing the A section 3 times in a row. 3 times in a row, people, okay? So A, A, B, A, back to the start, A, A, because it's very common to hit the bridge too early. That's one of the biggest pitfalls of playing any A, A, B, A song, but especially one with no chord changes like this. So, A, A, B, A. Now, try and ingrain that in your head. So when you get to the end of the form and you've got the last 8-bar section, just kind of try and register in your head that you're going back to the start and play something that's going to really make it clear that it's the start of a new chorus. So the structure couldn't be easier. Now, what do we do if you want to improvise on this song? This is a relatively easy song to improvise on because you don't have to worry about the chords changing all the time. This is called modal music, for those of you that don't know. And it basically means that you have one scale, a bit more like the Indian classical tradition or many other traditions from around the world, where you just have a tonality and you can pick out your notes from that scale. Now, starting with tenor pitch, for the first A, the second A, and the last A, the chord is an E minor 7, and the scale is an E minor Dorian scale, which is just a fancy way of saying it's a D major scale, but you start on the note E. So a mode just means you take a scale and you start on a different degree, which gives you a new scale. In this case, it's called E minor Dorian. Now, when you get to the bridge, this is in tenor, you're going to go up a semitone. And the new scale is F minor Dorian, which is the notes of E flat major starting on F. Here we go. And then you're back to the scale that you started with for the final 8. Now, if you play alto, the scale is a B minor Dorian, which is the notes of A major starting on B. So 3 sharps, F sharp, C sharp, and G sharp. When you get to the bridge, you take it up a semitone and it's C minor Dorian, which is the same notes as a B flat major scale. So for alto, you've got an A major scale and then you've got a B flat major scale in the bridge. Now, whatever you do, when you get to the bridge, Make sure you don't miss that change, because if you start playing an A major scale, it's going to be a semitone away. It's going to be horrific. So that's one way that you can instantly show people that you know exactly what you're doing, which is making the right change at the right time. Let's have a little look in the comments before we go on. Hi, Wayne from Montreal. We've got Quado from Ghana, Tangai from France, Patty Music from Germany. Hi to all you guys. Now then, how do you sound good when you're soloing in this if you've just got a simple major scale? So you can go and find my video, which is 3 tips to sound better when you're soloing. You can find that video linked in the description for this video, and it's got 3 simple tips. The first one is to leave some space, leave some gaps. The temptation is just to keep noodling and noodling and noodling, and you'll just get lost in the noodles and it'll end up being really boring for your listener. So leave some space. The second tip is to play something simple and rhythmic. You know, I stress rhythmic. One of the most important things you can do is play rhythmically. So play something right in the groove, even if it's just a couple of notes. I mean, listen to Miles Davis's solo. He just plays the most sparse solo, but it's so beautiful and swinging. So you don't always have to play, you know, as simple as that, but make that your starting point. Simple and rhythmic. If you've got a really good idea, but it's badly played, it'll just sound bad. On the other side, if you've got a bad idea and you play it really well, it's going to sound better than the good idea played badly, if that makes any sense. So the third thing is to try and use small melodic cells to have a little conversation with yourself. So you play one thing, you might play it again, you might answer it in a different range. You might play another little, say, 3-note cell, 4-note cell, and then you transpose it up, you transpose it down. So in order to do this, you have to be really familiar and fluent with the major scales of the song. So it's all about, for tenor players, you really shed that D major scale all over your sax, and you shed your E flat major scale. And for alto, make sure that your A major scale is really fluent and your B flat major scale is really fluent. But not just going up and down, practice doing the scale in leaps and triads, because you've got all sorts of nice shapes within those scales that you can use when you're soloing on So What. So I'm going to put the backing track on, not the head section, but from where the solos start. I'm just going to back it up a little bit and I'm going to try and demonstrate that for you. Here we go. Fingers crossed again on the tech. So that'll give you a little example. That was quite a simple little example of just using some simple cells, leaving a bit of space, trying to play something nice and rhythmic. Now, if you want to take things a little bit further, within the major scale, there are 3 major triads. So, for example, if you're in a concert pitch of this tune and you've got D minor 7 Dorian, which is a C major scale, within a C major scale, you've got a C triad, you've got an F triad, and you've got a G triad. So you can use those triads when you're improvising to use strong melodic cells to work with. So, for example, in the first A section, you've got these triads. Which for tenor players is an A triad. a G triad, and a D triad. And if you're an alto player, you have got, let's have a little look. I'm not playing alto at the moment. I've got to switch my brain around. So you've got a D triad, you've got an A triad, and you've got a... what else have you got? Hang on a sec. So A triad, and then on the third, D triad as well. They're your three triads if you're an alto player. So I'm just going to demo it again with the backing track, trying to use those triads as strong melodic cells that you can use in your solos. Here we go. This is just one level more advanced. If you just want to noodle on the major scale, that's absolutely cool as well. Here we go. So there's a little example of using those nice triads built into your solo. Now, as a quick recap, let's go over it. So we've got the head, which is just those four notes. We've got the structure, which is A, A, B, A. Now, the important thing about this tune when you're playing it is to really keep that in your head. So when you get to the end of the last A section, think, okay, reset, back to the start with two new A sections. Then we've got the two scales to learn. So get really familiar with those scales, break them up into patterns. And when you're taking a solo, leave some gaps. Make sure that you are playing something very rhythmic. And make sure that you can use, possibly using triads, but not necessarily, just do a little idea and then try and answer it and do something logical. Otherwise, it tends to turn into a real sort of mush of just nothing noodling. So there's some hot tips for playing So What. Now, there's a real bonus feature about learning So What, and that is that you get two tunes for the price of one. So the second tune that you get with exactly the same chords is Impressions by John Coltrane, although it's quite a bit faster. So if you go down to, let me just flick across back to here. Oops-a-daisy. Hang on, bear with me. Right, that's that. Let's go to here. Right, yeah, if you go down into the link there and get the free PDF, which has got the whole head written out and all the scales for alto and tenor sax, so that's a really cool feature anyway, you also get access to two MP3s. One is the So What backing track that we've been listening to, and the other is the Impressions backing track, which I'm going to play just shortly. So I'm going to play through, using some of those ideas, I'm going to play through So What first, and then I'll show you how you can apply that a little bit faster with Impressions. I'm going to play the whole of So What once I get the right thing on here. So fingers crossed, let's do this. Thank you. Okay, so there's a little demo of how you can use some of those techniques to play on So What. Now, that's all just using the one scale. You can start taking it outside, of course, as well. And that's a whole different video. Now, I said it was two for the price of one. So we can also play Impressions by John Coltrane, which is exactly the same chord sequence with a different melody. So I'm going to keep the music up for So What because it's the same chords. Let's give this one a little whirl. Okay, so that was Impressions by John Coltrane, and if you go to the link in the description, you can get your backing track, that exact backing track, in fact. Now, we're about to move on to the Q&A session, so start thinking about any questions you've got, put them in the comments. I know there's like a 20-second delay sometimes for me to get them, but I'll try and answer your question about anything I can. I'm sure that you'll ask me something that I have no clue about whatsoever. I'm just having a little look and see if anyone's got anything they'd like to know. You can ask me anything about sax, and I'll do my very best to answer it. Here we go. Let's go on to the Q&A session. Okay, let's have a little look at the comments then. So who have we got? We've got people tuning in from, let's have a little look. Where's everyone from? Coulien from Greece. Tagai from France. I've mentioned a couple of these before. Enrica. Annika from Jamaica. Robert from West Midlands in the UK. Rodrigo in Brazil. How you doing? Big up all you guys. We've got Darren from Wolverhampton. Robert Hancock from Cheshire, hello to you. Ian Sinclair, Byron Bay, Australia. Wow, late in the day for you. Night owl, nice one. Javier, doesn't say where you're from, but thanks very much for tuning in. Okay, let's have a little look. I've got a question here. Let's see if I can get this one up on the screen. Okay, there we go. The question is, when I play the B-flat under the sound, it gurgles. If I put the mouthpiece further in, it stops doing it, but the notes come out very sharp. When I play the B flat under the sound, I'm not quite sure what that means. Rodolfo, can you explain what you mean by the B flat under the sound? Do you mean the low B flat gurgling? We'll come back to that one. DC Langer, great way to wake up. Good morning from Southern California. Jamie sounded great as usual. Thank you very much, DC Langer. You're very welcome. So we've got people from all over the world just waking up and people who it's probably long past their bedtime. Darren Elson says, hi, I'm new to playing alto sax about 1 year. Let's add this to the broadcast. I cannot read music. Any ideas to help? Well, I do have a video which is called How to Read Music, which is one of the first videos I ever did, like third or fourth videos maybe. So go into the playlist for beginners on the Get Your Sax Together channel and have a look at that. It just takes time. You've got to be very patient and you have to realize that Rome was not built in a day. Hi to Ben from Singapore. Fantastic. We've got Jürgen, who I saw earlier today. How are you doing, mate? Long time. Yeah, exactly. One of my online students. Okay. Yeah, you're quite right, Tenor. The major triads are E-flat, B-flat, and A-flat, right? I think you're talking about the bridge of So What, and you're asking what the triads are. Yep, E-flat triad, A-flat triad, and B-flat triad. That is quite right for tenor on the bridge of So What. You've got those triads quite right. Okay, Rodolfo's come back and said, sorry, low B-flat, right. Sometimes low notes do gurgle on certain saxes, and it's not something that is necessarily very easy to sort, but one thing you can try at least, which I've seen some people do, is you get a wine cork or a champagne cork and you just drop it into the bell of your saxophone, and sometimes that gets rid of the turbulence of the air in the bend of the sax, which causes that note to gurgle. So there's a quick and easy answer. It might not sort it out, but try putting a cork in your bell, Rodolfo. Virgil Blanc, you rule man. Thank you very much. Very kind. Brian has got an overtones question. Let's get that one up here. I can get one octave up and the fifth higher than that, but for the life of me, I can't get to the second octave. Any ideas? Hard to read. Right, Brian, have you checked out my video on altissimo? Because that will answer your every problem, not just about altissimo. It'll answer every problem you've got in life. It's my best video ever. But the basic problem is that when you want to play high overtones, you need to recruit your vocal tract formation, because the vibration of the reed is caused by the frequency of the air vibrating in the column of the instrument and the air vibrating in your throat. So you have to close your vocal folds, not completely, but you have to close them down a bit. You have to open up the soft palate at the back of your mouth, and that will create a standing wave in your vocal tract, which will influence the vibration of the reed and helps you to play those high overtones and altissimo notes. So basically the answer to the question is go and watch my video on altissimo. I can't remember the number, but it's about 7 or 8 videos again, maybe. Okay, a question from DJ Silversax. Have you tried Legere reeds? And the answer to that is no, I have. Oh, well, I have ages ago, but not since the reeds have got much better. So, yeah, that's something I'm definitely going to look into. So if you are a representative of Legere reeds and you're watching this, consider me somebody who's interested in trying your products. Right, next one. Anika John, any suggestions for breathing exercises? Almost as we speak, I am working on a new course, which is going to be called Total Tone Mastery. Now, that course has got a huge module on breathing on it, and there's loads of fantastic exercises. So, number one, watch this space for that course coming out. But in the meantime, you want to try and increase the volume of air that you get in and the speed that you can get that air out. So the main thing about breathing is to make sure that you're not lifting your shoulders and creating tension in your neck when you breathe in. You want to breathe in all across your chest and your belly. And then you want to use your chest muscles and your back muscles and the abdominal muscles around your whole torso to squeeze your lungs and get that air out without creating tension in your neck and shoulders. There's so many breathing exercises, aren't there? I can't think of just one immediate breathing exercise, but one way of practicing controlling your breathing is doing a thing called a box breath. It's not necessarily a saxophone specific exercise, but it's a good breathing exercise. You just breathe in for a certain number of counts, let's say 4 counts. You breathe in, you hold your breath at the top without creating tension for 4, and then you breathe out for 4 and you hold for 4 at the end. So those counts are the 4 sides of the box, if you like. So you would go in, hold, 2, 3, 4, out, 2, 3, 4, and hold at the bottom, 2, 3, 4. Now, not only that will improve your breathing, it improves the control of the recoil of your muscles for breathing, but it will result in you being extremely chilled out in a very meditative state, I can assure you. So that's one quick breathing exercise there. Who we got next? Okay, same question on overtones there from Tangai. Let's find, okay, Mandy Bruce, thank you for your question. Are there differences in grades between reed brands? Would a 2 be a new with all brands? And would a Legere be the same size as Kane? Would a 2 be a new? Not quite sure what that means. The difference in grades. I mean, yeah. If you're asking, is a, you know, a Ricoh Royal 2 the same as a Hemke 2 or whatever, they should be in theory. But because it's a living piece of wood, you know, this isn't always going to be the case. Even within one box of the same brand, there'll be different strengths. Now, if you go to Leger's website or something, they'll be able to tell you exactly what strengths match up. And I think they should be broadly similar, but I'm not really an expert on synthetic reeds right now. But the answer is it should be in theory, but it probably isn't in practice. That's the best I can do on that answer right now. Who else have we got then? Richards from Nigeria. Thanks for tuning in. Big love to you as well. All right, okay. Ben D, will you kindly teach us in a future video how to play Branford Marsalis' tenor solo in Shanice's I Love Your Smile? Appreciate it, thank you. Can't say I'm familiar with it. I'll go and check it out. And if it's something that's going to be a good fit for the channel, yeah, I mean, I'm a massive Branford fan, as I'm sure everyone is. Okay, Gang of Greenhorns says, the Barry contrabass player for the Moon Hooch does that Wim Hof breathing technique, and that will really exercise your lungs and diaphragm. Yeah, I think Wim Hof's absolutely fantastic in terms of transformational breathing practices. Yeah, definitely Wim Hof is the man. Dave Nagin, you're very welcome. Thank you very much. Let's see if I can pick out any more questions here. All right, so let me see if I can pronounce this one. Shakya Sidi, maybe. Sorry if I've got that wrong. Shakya, that's easy. From Hertfordshire. Great playing. Play synthetic reeds, and sometimes there's a crackling sound on some notes. It's not excess spit or necessarily to do with synthetic reeds. That's easy to say. Any suggestions? My suggestion is that I drink some coffee, which I've left too long, and it's all cold now. That's a bummer. So let's have a think about this question. There's a crackling sound on some notes. It's not excess spit. Honestly, I'm not exactly sure how to answer that question, other than trying a few different reeds. Maybe if you've got like a reed geek, you could try smoothing it down a bit, see if that helps. If it's like the fibers were a bit rough or something like that. You got me on that one. All these, like, quite often it's difficult to answer questions, but if you were here next to me and you showed me what was happening, I might have a better idea, but it's a bit limited sometimes with questions like that, so I apologise for that. Right, Kai, is there a way to speed up tonguing? Having troubles when playing fast 16th notes in a sequence? Okay, that's a good question. So, speeding up tonguing, quite often people will have a metronome and they'll just try and tongue as fast as they can. But another way to do it is to do it in groups. So you do a double tongue, not double tonguing, but you tongue two notes like this. And then you can try speeding that up and then add a third note. So you're kind of practicing the recoil of your tongue, and then you can add a fourth note. Because your tongue, it gets fatigued very fast. If you try and keep going and going, that tongue will just, it'll just die on you, won't it? And then you can try going up to five notes. And then slowly you can try joining up those groupings together and minimizing the gap between them. Do all this with a metronome, of course. And that way your tongue will learn to get going faster before it gets really tired and sluggish. So I hope that answers the question. That's one way of practicing tonguing. Hello to Junior from the Dominican Republic. Wow, it's such an international show. Phil, I joined late, so I'm watching from the beginning. Thanks very much, as always. Now, Phil recommended the tune that you are going to enjoy learning on Sunday in 2 days' time. And it is Tyvonne Pennicott's Wicked Tenor Solo on Hey Laura by Gregory Porter. So that's coming out at 7 a.m. UK time. As always, I'm going to sax up your Sunday with Gregory Porter's Hey Laura sax solo. So thanks to Phil for recommending that one. Wicked suggestion that was. Really enjoyed doing that one. I think you're going to enjoy learning it as well. Right, let's look at Jazz Guy 1304. Okay, Jazz Guy, I have a problem with growling. Is the mouthpiece metal? Is the mouthpiece metal could help? Do you mean will having a metal mouthpiece help? I don't think it will. So the way to growl, and I've got a video on growling on saxophone. If you're watching the replay, I'll make sure that the link for all the videos I'm mentioning goes in the description. But there's two main ways of growling on sax. Excuse me. The first one is that you hum. Now, you don't hum the note you're playing. You hum any old note. And then you blow at the same time as you're humming. So the way to do it is to hum first and then practice blowing while you're humming. So you just go. Sorry, that's probably creating a load of wind on the mic doing that. So you hum and you blow, and then it sounds like this. That's the first way of growling. The second way of growling is that you roll your tongue. That gives you a more dramatic kind of Junior Walker type growl. If you like Jubel, the tune, the dance tune Jubel, Snake Davis, who played the sax on it, does both those types of growling in that solo. And you can learn how to play Jubel in the two parts on my channel that teach you how to play that song as well. So they're the two methods about how to growl. I don't think a mouthpiece will make any difference to growling. You could growl on any mouthpiece. It won't make it any harder or easier, as far as I know. Right, now then, we've got the reverse question to Brian here from Mark. Similar to Brian, but the other way around. I can get the fifth and second octave okay, but I have to really concentrate to get the first octave, and then it's hit and miss. You're in a Yanagisawa T991. So, this probably means that your embouchure might be a little bit... it probably means that your embouchure will be a little bit tight. Look at this. Look at that. That is service, people. Employee of the Year award for you, love. It probably means that your embouchure is too tight. Sorry about the inadvertent coffee break. If you're getting all those high harmonics, you're probably pinching too much. That would be my sort of off-the-cuff suggestion there. Right, what we got? So Mandy Bruce has come back. Said, sorry, would a 2 be a 2 with all brands? Yeah, basically a 2 is a 2. A 2 read is a 2 read for all brands, yeah. But like I said, there may be variations in practice. Right, a bit of advice from Gang of Greenhorns. He says, if you try Legeres, they tend to be harder than cane. Like an Orange Rico 3 is softer than a 2.5 Legere Signature. There you go. So, Mandy, question has been answered by the community. Thank you very much. Hi, Gita from Amsterdam. Nice, welcome to the show. Julie LV, signatures are great. Not sure what you mean by that, but thanks for the comment. Okay, Rodrigo is asking, Jamie, do you teach via Skype, for example? How could I contact you to get information about private sax classes? Yeah, I do get asked this. I do have a waiting list, and you can email me on the usual address, which is info@getyoursaxtogether.com. info@getyoursaxtogether.com. I'll put you on the waiting list, and I'll give you all the information I teach via Zoom, especially in light of this COVID malarkey. So talking of COVID, I had my regular gig at the Ritz Hotel in London, famous Ritz Hotel. I'm in the resident band for the in the restaurant there. And I play there every Friday, or I did until COVID. Then the gig came back and we had 5 gigs at the Ritz. And I was all smug because I was the only one in the country with a gig virtually. And now it's shut down again. Would you believe it? So boo for COVID, I say, and boo for me not having any gigs because of it. But yeah, the reason I mentioned COVID is that during COVID, I switched to teaching via Zoom. And what that's done is opened up all sorts of people from all over the world. As Jürgen said, I taught him and he's in Germany much a bit earlier today. So, yeah. Hi, Charis from Cyprus. You're very welcome. Thanks for tuning in. Greetings from Argentina. Wicked. So many people from all over the world. I love it. Thank you for making videos with so much dedication, quality and good topics. You are most welcome. And thank you very much for watching. And thanks to everybody for watching all my stuff. I am always blown away by the support I get. I'm very humbled. So thank you all very much. Much appreciated. Your support is much appreciated. Let's see what else we got in here. Okay, now this is interesting. From Marco, is it make a big difference to switch my tenor neck from brass to bronze? I would recommend that you watch the latest Better Sax video that Jay has just put out and I've watched, which is about, I can't remember his name now, but he hand makes saxophone necks and he tries the bronze ones and all the rest of it. Personally, I've never tried it, so I can't comment, but that is a video worth watching, so tune in to Better Sax, which is a fantastic channel anyway, as I'm sure you all know. Okay, Alan from St. Albans, which is in the UK, says, hi Jamie, been playing 2.5 years, still can't achieve elusive altissimo G. Keep trying, but is it early days? Alan, can you just... I mean, I know your name, so I probably should know what sax you play. Is it alto or tenor? But I can't remember. So just come back to me and tell me if you play alto or tenor because they're different fingerings. Tim says, any chance to add Richie Canata solo from Billy Joel's Scenes from an Italian Restaurant to your ever-growing list of awesome tunes? Yeah, okay, I'll add it to the list. That is a deal, Tim. right. Let's see what else we got down here. Hi from Newcastle upon Tyne. Hi, Rico, not sure. I have a problem with condensation in my metal mouthpiece. After playing for 10 minutes, my sound changes and I feel there's a lot of saliva in my mouthpiece. Help. I'm sure on a previous live, somebody answered that question, which is a sort of mouth saliva related question. And I can't remember what the answer was now, I'm afraid. But there was quite a good question to that. So go back to one of the first, I think it might be in the first Q&A actually. And hopefully that'll answer your question. Right. Junior says, mouth or nose breathing? So if you're doing breathing exercises, it's usually a good idea to use your nose because you can get really good focus. But if you're playing saxophone, you need to breathe in through your mouth because you do not have time to get enough air through your nose to get the kind of volume of air that you need to play sax. So breathe in through your mouth for a saxophone, but for quite a lot of breathing exercises, you'll use your nose. Breathing in through your nose triggers your autonomic nervous system that everything is cool and relaxed, and it'll give you a really nice relaxed feeling when you breathe in through your nose. I think it's something about the little hairs inside your nose trigger the parasympathetic nervous system. There you go. I should have got my lab coat for that one. I've got my lab coat over there. Okay, let's see what else we got. We've got another few minutes. Thanks for answering my question, Jazz Guy. You're very welcome. Brunswick, Canada. New Brunswick, Canada. Okay. David Smookler says, let's put this one up, sorry. I can hardly get any notes from the mouthpiece alone. One of your practice exercises. How do you improve your range? That's a good question. Sorry, I'm a bit phlegmy today. It's that kind of kids are gone back to school, bugs flying around. Right. Let's turn this down so I don't deafen you. I have noticed that some people have trouble blowing their mouthpiece. Typically, it'll be because your embouchure is too tight. So you need to really relax your embouchure and let it hang down nice and loose and just have enough pressure that you can get a sound with your lip touching the bottom. But don't try and push the reed up with your bottom lip. So that's one common problem. In terms of getting a range on your mouthpiece, that's about controlling the movement of your larynx. So try and get the highest note you can and then bend down. Just doing this, It's like a sort of slight swallowing or yawning motions. Different people describe it different ways, but that's how you work on your range. And you should aim to try and get an octave eventually. So that's my little bit of advice on playing the mouthpiece, but it's a very useful exercise and it teaches you control. The second thing you can do is start to learn to play melodies with just your mouthpiece. So you can take something simple or you can take something complicated. Let me try and think of something. Let me see if I can play So What, seeing as we've been working on that today. You're not going to get any prizes from your neighbours for this one, I'm afraid. But if you can accurately pitch the notes, then that shows that you're developing really good control of your larynx. All right, let's see what else we got here. I thought we were going to run out of steam. I thought I was clear. I thought I was home and dry, but now there's been loads of other stuff come in. Anyway, I am here to serve. Your wish is my command. So what else we got? Nanodive says, Nanodive maybe. Hi, I have trouble finding a way to produce the high F sharp in a soprano sax King W that doesn't have that key from the factories. Any idea how to get it? Well, actually, have you tried the sort of tenor F sharp fingering, which is front F, side B flat, and your first finger? Try that. I'm not sure if it'll work. Because my soprano's over there, I haven't got time to get it out. Hopefully that'll work for you. That's the kind of pretty standard alternative F sharp on sax anyway. All right, Alan says he plays tenor, but now I have forgotten his question. So let's just go back up. The Altissimo G, that's it. Right, it is a bit of a recalcitrant note. It doesn't really want to come out and play that G, does it? It's a bit of a horrible one. But one way of trying to get it would be to do a front F and then a front F sharp, exactly the way I just described it with the side B flat and first finger, and then just flick off from the F sharp up to the G to try and fake it, you know, fake it till you make it, like this. What I suspect is happening when you play that G is that you get this. And that means you've got to go and watch my video on Altissimo, as previously mentioned, because that will answer your questions about that. Hope that helps, Alan. Right, Ian St. Clair, what is your setup, mouthpiece, reed brand, strength, regards, Ian? That's a really easy one. That's the easiest one of the day. Bless you for that one. I've got a Selma Mark VI tenor saxophone, quite a late one, 227,000. So yeah, one of the last ones made. And I've got a USA, hang on, is it USA model? Yeah, I've got a USA model Autolink, Florida model they call it, because it was made in the Florida factory and it's got the USA stamp on it, which makes it slightly later than the no USA ones. And it says it's a 8. It's stamped 8. But when I measured the tip opening myself, I made it more like a 9, actually, to be honest. And my reeds are Van Doren Red Box. Van Doren Java Red Box. This one is either a 3 or a 3.5. I mix it up between 3s and 3.5s. So that answered that question. Love you to put the Coltrane solo and flamenco sketches in your list. Yeah, Mohammed says, I'd love to put you the flamenco. Yeah. Of course. Now, the problem is doing a whole jazz solo or a whole any solo is difficult with the format that I do it. I nearly killed myself doing Us and Them, a Pink Floyd solo. So doing a Coltrane solo. Yeah, that'll put me to an early grave, I reckon. I would advise you to try and transcribe it yourself. If you're good enough to play it and want it on the channel, I'd advise you to transcribe it yourself. And I've done a whole series on how to transcribe. So go to my playlists and find the How to Transcribe playlist. Benjamin Jimenez says, play Jubel real quick. Do you want me to play Jubel real quick, or do you want me to quickly play Jubel? Okay, I'll play Jubel, but I don't know it off by heart, so let me find the PDF. Aren't there? There's two PDFs for this, so just bear with me. What I need to do now is cue. Here we go. Cue, you know, the background music while you wait for Girl from Ipanema. Okay, let me try and play this for you then. I'll have to try and arrange this PDF somewhere where I can see it. Right, that's the Alto version. Tenor version. Okay, here we go. I don't think I've got the backing track to hand, so I'm just going to play it without the backing track. That's about the best version I can do of it, put on the spot like that. Okay, Robert, KB Saxnex. Greetings from Peru. Yeah, thanks for that. That's what I was talking about earlier. I love it when everyone answers my questions. Should be your show, really. Gang of Greenhorns, you're very welcome. So, good luck with all that, and I'll see you next time. Who else have we got? My mouthpiece alone, it should sound different from my one. Linkus Studio, I'm not 100% sure what you mean by that. Kai, not rail to sax playing really, still have problems with offbeat playing. Any advice or exercises? Any advice or exercises to play offbeats? Well, what you're talking about generally is just having a strong sense of rhythm. So you could start really simple and just practice tapping your foot or clapping, you know, along on the beat to music, because even that isn't the easiest thing in the world for some people. Then you could try practicing playing, you know, clapping the offbeats and then playing them along with a metronome or a piece of music, and try and get your body into it. You know, you can ingrain the rhythm in your body, and that's really going to help you out. So that's a little quick answer to that one. Benjamin says, I can't seem to get to D. I don't know if it's a problem with my sax or if I'm not playing it right. Any tips? I don't know what D you're talking about, and I don't know if it's a problem with your sax because I haven't tried it. So a bit tricky to answer that one in this forum, I'm afraid there, dude. Okay, Kirsty Duncan, how are you doing? Good to see you on the chat. What alto, by the way, Kirsty was a runner up in my opening competition. What alto mouthpiece would you, if it's the same Kirsty Duncan, that is, what alto mouthpiece would you recommend for cutting through in a funk band? Haha. I think I know what that question relates to after your email. So I don't know. I don't have a really cutting mouthpiece, but maybe definitely something with a baffle, like, oh, this lot, they'll answer it for you. Everyone loves a bit of mouthpiece chat. Jody Jazz do a nice one with a step baffle, which will really cut through, as do probably Theo Wane. But you could also get like a Dukov or a Berg Larsen or one of those more old school ones. Or maybe you could get a Sios. Try a Sios one, like a really bright, Sios mouthpiece that you can design yourself to get maximum brightness. Okay, last question, which is from Bernard Jean. How do you play a bend up? I've got a whole video on scoops, bends, falls, and all the rest of it. And you can go and find that. I'll try and put a link in the description. But basically, you use your... you use your larynx to pitch the note lower and then you scoop up to it. And the way to practice it is to hit the note, bend down, and then bend up. And then practice just starting from the lowest part of the bend. And sometimes you can help the pitch bend up by using, like, for example, I was on an A there, you could bend up by fingering a G sharp, but using your throat to bend it. There's actually quite a good exercise that I can quickly teach you for practicing how to bend notes, which is going to be in my Total Tone Mastery course. Little sneak preview for you folks. Although I must admit, I did adapt this exercise from someone else. So you would play D, palm key D to C sharp to D, and then you would bend the same thing. And then you would play palm key D, play C, back to D, and bend that and keep going like this. Ah, it doesn't want to go down a fourth, does it? So that's how you can practice bending. But even if you can bend a tone, that's pretty good. I mean, I went down a fourth. That's much more than you would ever need to do. So thank you all very much for joining me. Don't forget, you can get your free PDF and those fantastic MP3 backing tracks for free. You're welcome. Help yourself. Just go to www.getyoursaxtogether.com/So what? All one word. So what? Don't forget, you can get much more of this in my free 1-hour masterclass, which is my gift to you to say thank you for following my channel and being so supportive. www.getyoursaxtogether.com/masterclass for that free 1-hour thing, 1-hour masterclass with me if you haven't seen it already. So I'll be back on the last Friday, usually a Friday, of the month. Of course, I'll let you know if you're on my mailing list, and I'll put it on YouTube community as usual. You can go and check out my socials, my Instagram and my Facebook. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, click the bell icon to be notified when I upload new videos or go live on all that good stuff. Thank you, as always, for following Get Your Sax Together. Look forward to Sunday's video, which is Hey Laura by Gregory Porter. Wonderful to see you all, and I'll see you live next month. You can, of course, watch this on the replay for your whole lifetime. Until then, practice smart, enjoy your music, stay safe, stay healthy, and I'll see you next time. Au revoir.